Macmillan Audio presents Return of Souls, A Song for No Man's Land, Book 2, by Andy Remic. Read for you by Tim Gerard Reynolds. Part 1. Hunted. The Rustling Jungle. A Taste of Reality. 17th of August, 1917. Robert Jones, 3rd Battalion Royal Welsh Fusiliers, sprinted through the trenches, filled with an absolute mind-destroying terror. Ahead, the routes lay deserted. Behind, around a corner in the moonlit painted trench like some scene from a ghastly, sick painting, he could hear heavy, lumbering boots pounding the duckboards. They were coming for him. Coming fast. Rain fell, cooling skin, drenching his coat and hair and face. His boots thudded on uneven boards as he powered on, fingers flexing uselessly, as if in some unbidden awareness that he had no weapon. No weapon. He stopped suddenly, sliding on treacherous mud-slick timber. His hand steadied himself against the damp earth wall, fingers leaving tiny indentations. Above him, thick streamers of twisted barbed wire rattled in the wind. He listened. There. Again. They were following. He could hear boots raking the boards, clattering as they pounded down a parallel communications trench to his left. Jones ducked down, kneeling, cowering against the damp mud wall which stained his coat, trying to hide from them, whatever they were. Water soaked through his trousers, and his toes went numb with the cold. I wish I had my fucking SMLE, he thought, mouth dry, eyes tired, mind firing like a tank's massive roaring engine. He patted his pockets, looking for a blade or pistol. He remembered Bainbridge's Beholder, of which the man had been so proud. Jones could have done with that gun now. Suddenly, he realized the sounds of charging boots had stopped. His head came up, looking around. Where were they? Dumb. Dumb. Move! His instincts screamed at him, and he heard the scrabbling of stones and soil, glancing up as a huge black shadow loomed above him. It was big, wearing a heavy German overcoat, but within this shell, its body was slick and black, thick twisted coils like oiled tree roots. The face was narrow and pointed, and merged with a Hun helmet, flesh and metal fused. Grey eyes narrowed, long yellow fangs curling up from a disjointed jaw that looked more like machinery, cogs in clockwork. It screeched and leapt at him from the top of the trench, but Jones was already kicking backwards, slipping and sliding, and the creature hit the duckboards, slipping itself, pitching forward, and Jones saw his opportunity. He leapt, boot lashing out, connecting with the creature's jaw. It howled, stumbling back, and Jones waded in, fists flying, right straight, left uppercut, all the while fear and disgust rioting through him. What is it? His mind screeched. What the fucking hell is it? He planted his fist in its face, snapping a long yellow fang, but then something heavy landed on his back, crushing him to the ground. Ah, there were more. His head lashed backwards, and he felt something break, but then something appeared before his eyes. It was a long, curved bayonet, etched with runes and rust. Slowly it turned before his eyes, as if he were being offered the chance to survey this murder weapon before it did its dirty work. No, he managed, as he watched the creature in front of him stand and touch its broken fangs tentatively. Steam came in snorts from its nostrils, and those grey eyes fixed on him with total evil. The bayonet pressed against his throat.
"What are you?"
he managed. The face loomed close, and it stank like a corpse. Jones realized it was grinning.
"We wall riders. We eat you now."
The face seemed to twist and grow in his vision, and he struggled violently, trying to break free as all that time the terrible stink invaded him, raped him, forced itself down into his very core. The shell blast rocked the trench, shrapnel screamed, fire roared, and the very world seemed to fall down to hell. Jones felt the weight from his back lifted and blasted back down the trench, bouncing from walls like a broken doll. The wall rider before him was slammed against him, grunting, and he felt its body being pounded by the blast of shrapnel, wave after wave, until Jones could take no more. Thought he'd be crushed to death by sheer pressure. And then, peace. He opened his eyes to stare into the dead wall rider's face. Its tongue was poking out to the side like a purple slug. Joan saw the one remaining yellow fang and noted it was hollow. With all his strength, he heaved the heavy corpse from himself, watched it topple back, overcoat smoking. Above, stones trickled down into the trench. Jones frowned. He was sure he heard a scrabbling sound, like thorns clacking on stone. "This is a nightmare," he thought. He blinked. The world, the trenches, the wall rider corpses all faded to black, leaving shocking bright afterimages in his brain. The war was gone. Jones's eyes flared open, breathing sharp and fast in his ears, fingers clutching the blankets tight. And he was afraid. His breathing slowed. His eyes narrowed. And reaching across, he plucked a thorn splinter from his flesh, leaving a tiny bead of blood. Ypres Salient, Third Battle of Dugout Dreams, 18th of August, 1917. Robert Jones sat in the stale dugout, breathing the scent of mud, a plate of Jippo's steaming on his lap. But he had no appetite. He kept hearing voices. He could hear Bainbridge moaning about water in his rifle. He could hear Webb complaining about Bainbridge's bullying. Their voices gradually faded in Jones's mind, to be replaced by a low-level rumble of distant gunfire and a sporadic trembling of the earth. He stretched his neck, easing tension. He felt so low, so down. The depression had settled in his abdomen, and he felt physically sick. Slowly, Jones reached out, picked up his fork, and put a lump of meat in his mouth. It was cold. Had he been seated for so long? Jones chewed the meat. Horse, dog, who knew? Slowly, and swallowed. Then he pushed the bowl to one side, watched as it fell from the bunk and scattered contents across the bare earth floor. He lay back on his bed and closed his eyes. He could feel the meat inside him, cold, greasy, crying to get out, crying to be released. His eyes rolled backwards, and images of violence flooded his mind. Blood, death, a chest exploded with a bayonet thrust, blood spraying outwards, the man screaming, cutting his hands as he grabbed the sharp steel. Another, charging through a shell hole, then hit by a crump. Bam! Body parts exploding outwards in a hot hail rush of smoke and shrapnel and tattered strings of bloody flesh.
Pull yourself out of it, lad! You're being a fucking girl!
It was Bainbridge. Charlie Bainbridge. Joan sat bolt upright, eyes wide, mouth open, panting, hands clawing at the cheap, rough blankets. But he was alone. So terribly alone.
I wish I was back in Dol with Ellen, he thought. I wish I were back home.
He sat there for a minute, then for an hour, cradling his diary. But no words came. He could not write. He was alone. He was fucking alone, and he knew it. They were dead, both dead, and who could he turn to now? Jones kicked his bowl across the dugout and threw his diary onto Bainbridge's empty bunk. The world felt grey, and he wondered when the war would ever end. How could the bastards force men through all the shit? How could the brass hats expect good, honest men to endure such awful conditions, suffer through so much death? It was fucking arse a peak. Then Jones smiled for the first time in days.
You don't give a shit, do you? He whispered. You're all bastards. We're just numbers. Cogs in the machine of war.
It's a bad sign talking to yourself. I'm okay, Johnson. Come in, make yourself at home.
The sergeant stooped his head, ducked inside, and, eyes full of concern, sat opposite Jones. His muddied boot pushed a potato across the floor.
I see the food's up to its usual amazing standards.
Jones barked a laugh and lay back on his bunk.
It's like eating from a bin. Anyway, what brings you down here, Sergeant?
Don't play games, Jones. You know why I'm here.
Johnson leaned forward and placed a large, hairy hand on Jones's arm. The two men locked gazes.
Do I?
Yes. I care. You're a good soldier.
Jones gave a bitter laugh.
You're a good soldier, and I'll not see you give up now.
Listen, man, Bainbridge would want you to fight on. He'd want you to be brave.
Jones sighed. I know, but I miss him. I miss the old bugger.
So do I, Jones. He was my friend as well.
I'm sorry, Sergeant. I must appear completely self-centred, full of bloody horseshit.
No, you don't, lad. Yes, I do. I know I do. I'm lying here, wallowing in my bunk, but I need action. I need to get out there and do some killing or take a bullet myself. It's this waiting shit that's destroying my soul. At least when I'm shooting a rifle in a Hun's face, I'm marking up another notch for Bainbridge, getting some payback.
He lit a cigarette, coughed heavily on the blue-grey smoke.
You want one?
The sergeant shook his head, and Jones continued.
Am I going crazy, Sergeant? Has it finally got to me?
No, soldier. I feel like that sometimes. We all do. It's the trenches. It's watching your mates getting shot, watching them crawl through the mud towards you with hands outstretched, bullets cutting past as they drag themselves along, begging for life. And just as you reach out to pull them into the trench, a fucking piece of shrapnel takes off the back of their head.
Out here, we all go a little crazy. I know it sounds Irish, but it's the only way we can keep sane. You know.
Jones nodded and savoured his cigarette.
He only had three left.
Sergeant Johnson pulled a flask from his pocket, unscrewed the cap, and took a hefty swig. He offered it to Jones. "Want a shot?" Jones took the flask, enjoyed the burning in his throat because it told him he was still alive and still in control, despite reminding him of older, badder days. He handed the flask back. "How come sergeants are finding whiskey in these harsh times? I'll be damned if I know how you do it." "A privilege of rank, son. I'll just have to get promoted then." The taste was sweet on his lips, like a good woman.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.